Okay. Thank you, everybody, for coming this afternoon to listen, to continue to listen to Vox Booker's story of what happened to him this weekend at Lake Monroe in Bloomington, Indiana, and to continue to listen to Black Lives Matter, because that is what we need to do more of. So thank you again for coming today to listen to updates and to listen once again to Vox's story. We do have some breaking news. I can confirm that an official investigation has been opened up by the FBI. I believe it has been approved by the United States Attorney's Office, and they are investigating this as a hate crime. And I can tell you, as a criminal lawyer of over 30 years, I never thought I would say, boy, am I glad the FBI are coming. But we are. We want this investigated as a hate crime. It was clearly racially motivated. And the only reason why Vox Booker is still with us today is because his friends, his allies, came to his aid, and they weren't bystanders. They helped save him. Otherwise, I fear that we would be planning his memorial service right now rather than our continuing quest to have justice for Vox. So the new news is I can confirm the FBI has an active case, and they are investigating. We are cooperating with them. We are working with law enforcement to make sure they understand what happened that night, because the charging decision that the prosecutor's office is going to have to make is only as good as the information it receives. And so if we don't help make sure that the witnesses who were with Vox that night get their story to the prosecutor's office, then we won't know about charging decisions. So there have been additional rounds of interviews with primary witnesses. I can also confirm that. And the prosecutor's office has been keeping in close contact with those who are doing those interviews. And so, believe it or not, things are moving, and moving rather rapidly, considering it's the criminal justice system. Unfortunately, they did not move rapid enough on Saturday night. And the lapse in time for law enforcement to respond, the fact that it was DNR who responded, and the fact that they refused to arrest the people who tried to kill Vox Booker is more than disheartening. We will continue our quest every day until some justice is served and those people are held accountable for their hatred and violence that they showed to Vox and everyone in our community and our country by that behavior that night. So thank you for supporting them.
What's your name then?
Catherine Lyle.
Spell it, last
name? L-I-E-L-L.
Catherine with a K or a C?
K. And an A like Hepburn.
Hey folks, before I speak, this isn't only about me, this is about our entire community. I would like to invite John Hamilton, our mayor, to come up and share some words about the community response.
Taking this off because we're outdoors and we're 6 feet away. We're in the middle of a city that's 202 years old and a country that's 244 years old, and for most of that history, this has been a place where racism has been embedded in laws and culture. We've worked really hard to improve our community and our country, but we know we're not done. I'm here as the mayor of Bloomington, as the mayor for one of our residents, Vox Booker, who went through unspeakable danger and risk and physical harm just a few days ago. And my job is to help protect my residents. And I am sorry for what happened to Mr. Booker, and I'm going to cooperate fully to try to make sure that justice is done. We are cooperating, as you heard, with the federal and local authorities. Mr. Booker and I don't always agree on everything in Bloomington.
I appreciate it.
But we agree on this. And I'm here to support him and to try to make sure we can keep improving as a community. And I appreciate his leadership and standing up in the face of very difficult circumstances to try to help make us a better community, which is what we're about. Thank you.
Folks, if I could next introduce J.D. Ford and ask him to come to the microphone for a moment. Senator, J.D. Ford.
Thank you, Vox. Hi, friends. State Senator J.D. Ford, District 29, representing Carmel, Zionsville, Pike Township, and Wayne Township in the Indiana State Senate. I became aware of the situation, much like many of you, through the viral Facebook post that we saw, and was just disgusted and appalled with the videos that I saw. Immediately, reached out to my contacts at the Department of Natural Resources, as well as the state police, to make them aware if they hadn't seen those videos already. And so I've been working with them in that regard. But I'm here today to support my friend who is seeking justice. I did call Mr. Booker yesterday just to ask him how he was doing and to see if I could do anything on his behalf. And so I'm here today to support him and to make sure that he gets his justice. Thank you.
And our Democratic Senate nominee for District 9?
40.
40, thank you. I'm confused. I have a concussion, so I can get away with it.
I'm Shelley Yoder, and I will be representing this community in the State Senate. And I'm just calling all Hoosiers. We can be outraged. We must be outraged. We must be horrified. But we cannot be surprised. We must be active in what we need to do to be anti-racist in our community, in every community throughout Indiana. We Hoosiers will stand up. We will fight for justice for Vox. We must fight for justice for all Black lives. And I just want to make a very compelling plea to do the work, to be an ally, and to advocate. Because now more than ever, we are seeing how we are devaluing and dehumanizing Black lives. And we all must demand change, and that will begin within our own hearts and in our own communities. I stand with Vox, and I will be demanding justice for Vox.
Hello, folks. Thank you all for being here today. First, I would like to recognize our community leaders that so boldly stood up for justice. Each one of these folks reached out for me. They communicated, they advocated, they were warriors, and they exemplify some of the best folks in our community. I deeply appreciate them. In fact, Shelley was so kind enough to sneak by my front door and drop off groceries to me the day after I was attacked. What I want us to see is that we're not a community that hates. We're not a community where you can lynch someone. We're not a community where you can lynch someone in the street. We are a community that is welcoming, we're inclusive, and we're going to make sure that justice is served. I'm pleased that the FBI has announced this investigation. I'm saddened that it happened. Honestly, I just wanted to have a good time with some friends. But if this was gonna happen, at least I'm not alone. At least I have community leaders that are willing to stand up, that I live in a community where people are willing to stand up, and that I had friends and strangers who were willing to put their lives and their bodies on the line to make sure that a man that they didn't know, that looked different than them, was able to survive the situation. Without these folks, I would be a hashtag. All right. I'm done. It's not about me. If you would like to engage any of these folks in any questions, I will surrender the microphone.
Vox, I do have a quick question for you. Like any situation, there's going to be pushback. The people that are pushing back on this story, they say they have a lot of questions since, like a lot of the situations, the video that everyone's able to see starts in the middle of your attack. And a lot of people pushing back, in one of the videos where the man is using racial slurs towards you, and you're heard in the video asking him, what do you really want to call me? So what do you have to say to those people who are standing up for the other side, of the people who are seen in the video attacking you and using those racial slurs against you?
Here's the thing. I wanted that man to speak his truth because I wanted people to see the ugliness that exists in our community. We often talk about racism like it's an abstract thing. We've seen lots of videos that were blatantly racist, and folks still dismiss the racism. In this moment, I think it's undeniable when a group of white men feel that they can call for a noose, call me nappy-headed, scream out white power, and attempt to lynch a man in broad daylight. A lot of folks have criticized that I was the only black person out there. I reject the notion that this is America where black people can't go anywhere they want to do. Black people have hopes, dreams, and visions, and we are free to express them in any way, any shape, any form, any fashion that we should choose. Folks, a lot of folks said, well, if this man said white power, why did you go back and talk to him? My family's been in Indiana for 170 years. If you think this is the first time that I've encountered a racist white person, you understand what racism is. I've had a racist boss, friends with racist parents that I've had to have a dialogue to. I don't have the privilege to avoid racism in society. What I wanted to do was reach out to folks and see if we could establish a dialogue, if we could recognize each other's humanity, if we could build a better community. And sometimes you have to take that uncomfortable step.
And some people are calling upon, you know, wanting you to comment on your controversial departure from the local BLM chapter here. So could you comment on that?
You know, I was proud to be the organizer of BLM. I wrote the mission statement. Someone asked if I believed in the mission of BLM. Of course I believe in BLM. Black Lives Matter as more than just a movement, as in just a statement of fact. The issue with BLM is a sad departure. They felt like I shouldn't go towards electoral politics. People can try to qualify my character. But I think one of the most telling aspects here is people are out here questioning me who could have potentially been lynched, but they're not out there investigating the backgrounds of these men who try to lynch me. They're not asking about, well, what about the record of this guy who yelled out white power? That from before the cradle and after the grave, black people have to experience racism. I can't even be lynched without my character being called into question. I refuse to be a victim.
And do you feel that, you know, especially now that this, your videos have now gotten over 3 million views, hundreds of thousands of shares, what do you hope comes out of all of this as people continue to hear your story?
You know, my name is Vox. My dad said he named me that because it was the Latin for voice. He put a little spin on the spelling. But now that I've been given this voice, this platform, I intend to do the same thing that I did before I had it. I'm going to advocate for justice. I'm going to call out bias when I see it. I'm going to say it's not enough to simply not be racist, that we must be adamantly anti-racist. I'm going to be the person that those folks will for me. I'm going to be the person that steps in and is willing to put myself in the line.
Let me ask you, what's your message to, or your thoughts about, you know, recreation? Some groups have come out and said, you know, the Lake Monroe should be inviting for people of color, black people. And a lot of people feel unsafe going outside of Bloomington because of the color of their skin. Was that something that you were a little hesitant on when you went out there? And what's your message to people who want to venture out there, but they're afraid they may end up in the same shoes that you were in this past weekend?
This is Indiana. I understand that we have a history of sundown towns. If you folks don't know what that is, that's where if the sun set, that you would be in danger. I reject this notion that I'm going to hide away, to live in a bubble. We have to be willing to go anywhere and confront injustice when we see it. The thing about progress is it's never convenient. It always requires a struggle and sacrifice. And everyone in our community needs to be pushing their boundaries, stepping into uncomfortable spaces, advocating for folks who can't advocate for themselves.
You know, what's your thoughts about the peaceful rally that happened last night, kind of turned violent towards the end? What's your thoughts on that?
We had a moving rally. We saw children that had finger-painted signs, families calling out for justice. We saw the best of our community out in support of each other. I think we also saw the worst of our community come out. We saw folks who were violently willing to harm their neighbors. The way to respond to that hate is to speak against injustice. We need to show up for each other. We need to keep standing up. We need to keep having rallies. We're going to continue to rally today. We are going to demand that there be justice, not just in Bloomington, not just in Indiana, but it's time for this nation to change.
Mayor, I don't know if we could get you up here for a minute. We did talk to someone today who witnessed the incident yesterday where the car drove through the group of protesters, and I went to Bloomington, so I think anyone that has lived here for some time or maybe has gone to IU might view Bloomington as a very progressive city, very inviting to all people, but then this encounter has kind of turned that light in a different direction, and the person we spoke to today said that Bloomington maybe isn't as inclusive as we once thought it was, that it's kind of, there's a veil over it. Do you agree with that statement? Do you feel there's a lot of progress to be made in Monroe County and Bloomington outside of maybe the street of Kirkwood or maybe the courthouse square?
Well, as the mayor of Bloomington, let me be clear, everyone belongs in Bloomington. This is a community that opens our arms to people from all around the world, of all different shades and all different beliefs and all different lifestyles, and that's who we are and what we believe in, which does not mean that there aren't people who don't agree with that in Bloomington. There are people who don't like that change. As I said, this is a community that has a history like any other, and you heard Mr. Booker talking about that too. The event on last evening is being actively and aggressively investigated right now by the Bloomington police. That did take place in my city, unlike these other events that we've talked about, and we're actively investigating it, and we'll take whatever steps it takes to bring justice to that event. My first job as a mayor is to try to keep everybody safe, from a resident who's traveling to a lake for a nice evening, to people who are here to rally and protest and advocate, to people who are visiting our community. And we work really hard to do that, and sometimes people make it difficult, like a driver who caused a problem last night. We have not, as far as I know, as of this moment, obtained custody with that driver, but we're looking for them.
Hey folks, before you leave, and take on your camera equipment, I know a lot of folks had questions about what happened before these videos. Since I was being held down and beaten, I can't answer some of those. But if you would like to speak to one of the folks who came to my aid, we have Stephen Cox here.
Thank you, Steve.
Stephen, could you shed some light on the events that you witnessed leading up to the attack between the two parties, Vox's group and this other group of men who eventually held him into a tree? From your perspective, how did all of this happen?
It starts from a Facebook invite for a lunar eclipse view. And so I didn't know anybody there. I hadn't met Mr. Booker before this. And so I thought, I'll just go. And so I got stopped a couple times by the other group. I'm one that heard the white power screaming. I was harassed trying to get around to the place. So I finally did. And I said, you probably better tell some people that are coming to this event that it's what they might encounter. And so Vox thought that he needs to go talk to him. And he was very calm when he left. He's extremely calm. He's like, I just want to talk to him. That's all I want to do. Well, Ian didn't feel comfortable with him going on his own, so he went with him. And so a few minutes later, when they didn't come back, there was only five of us in the group. The three of us then took off to see what was going on. And we heard screaming and shouting, and we ran. We begged them to let him go. They wouldn't. The only ammunition we had at that time was our phones. We were far outnumbered. So when we got our phones out, they had other people in their group screaming to let him go because we had our phones out. But and so, yeah, I got my phone taken away and my arm grabbed. And so it was a scene, but I did not expect that. I'm IU employee here and lead a pretty quiet life.
And Vox, you know, had said multiple times yesterday that when they were holding him down, calling for a noose, threatening to harm him, he truly thought that they were trying to kill him.
Yeah.
As someone who was an outsider, kind of able to see all the moving parts of this, did you also think that it was a possibility
yes.
that Vox might not make it?
Yes. When they called him, you can leave the boy here, you guys can go, but you can leave the boy here. So the white people could go, but they wanted us to leave him there and to do what they wanted to with him. I don't think anybody could do that in good conscience. I'm not a fighter, so I'm like, but I wasn't going to leave. But it was scary. I mean, probably the scariest thing I've ever seen.
And when whoever it was called for someone to go get a noose, did anyone ever see a rope or a noose appear on the scene?
No, I did not see one, but the melee around that tree was really hard to see. The video you see is another person's video. I was shooting to the left, he was shooting here, and Max over here. So what we had was, in that situation, I couldn't tell who was screaming what. So the break his arm comment, the rope and a noose, I couldn't tell what was happening. There was lots of screaming. Mainly, a lot of for their other group telling him to let him go.
Had you ever witnessed something like this ever happening before?
No.
Describe what it was like to stand there and see all of this unfold so quickly, right in front of your eyes.
I mean, your heart races and it goes quick. And I was scared we were going to get beat up and, you know, and I didn't know what was going to happen with that. And I think all of us were pretty scared. I felt pretty resolved as we were walking back, but they kept following us, and then, you know, we got scared again, so we taped a lot of that.
And can you describe the moment that they eventually let Vox go, or when he got out of their custody? What led to that?
That's a great question, because I don't think anybody but one person saw that, because they were taking phones away and had my arms held back, and I was really trying to just get my phone back. Next thing you know, Vox is up. I don't know how he got up. I'm very clear about that. I do not see how he got up, but he did. And then when he did, we're like, it's got out of here. And so,
did the people that were holding him down, were they taking your phones away or swatting them out of your hands, or how did they get taken away from you and then returned to you?
Well, returned by grabbing them back. But okay. My phone was taken away from me by somebody on my left side and held my arm. And so I just wanted to put it back. So I tried to get it back, put it in my pocket. I took it in my pocket. So it's like, I just asked them, be respectful. I'm not going to fight you guys. I just want to let him go. And so that's kind of where that was. But it's all happened, and so I have no idea. Only those two men right there probably will know of how he actually got up from the ground, because it's a harrowing thing to see him down there.
As someone who witnessed it firsthand, are you surprised that no charges have been filed?
Yes. I thought arrests would have been made that night. I did. And I still expect and hope that needs to happen. Not everybody there, but the people in the video are pretty clear who they are. Anybody have anything else for me?
Can you just tell me your first or last name again?
Stephen Cox.
Spell it, Stephen.
S-E-E-V-E-N.
And V-E instead of P-H, okay.
Mm-hmm. And C-O-X. Is that it? Okay, thank you.
Thanks, sir.
Wait a minute, gentlemen. One more. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of folks have had a lot of questions. And grab a mic if you gotta grab the mic. I have one more individual that I would like to introduce to you all. This gentleman helped save my life. His name is Brennan Golightly.
Wow. Honestly, I had no idea I would be going in front of the cameras right now on my way down here. I just came.
A little closer.
Yeah. I just came down here to support my friend. Hi.
So, did you know Vox before this incident?
I'd met him once before, and briefly, and I'm sure he remembered me, and then we hung out for a couple hours prior to the incident.
So what was your role in all of this? Where were you when all of this was taking place?
I was camping. Myself and two others were camping back in the Hoosier National Forest. I hiked in along the shoreline, didn't even notice the other party. It's back there camping. An hour or so later, after I got there, Vox and Ian come walking up. Actually, I take that back. They did not walk up. We noticed a four-wheeler coming through the woods towards our camp. It stopped. Vox and Ian got out. He comes up and says, hey, we just ran into your neighbors. They said we weren't supposed to be here. And he drove us to he said he would drive us to the camp. So he comes up and says, so they drove Vox and me into the camp. They get out, come up and tell us their situation. Vox was a little shaken, but not bad. He wasn't upset. no big deal. So we hung out some more. About an hour after that, Steven comes walking in from a weird direction, not the normal path. He comes over to us, says, "Hey, these guys wouldn't let me pass. I tried to go on the shore. They blocked me off. There were people yelling white power." This is what Steven said. Vox heard this, and he was staying very calm, and he decided he wanted to just go calmly up to them and state his piece and try to, I think he was truly trying to calm things over. His demeanor when he left, he wasn't angry, he wasn't violent. He wanted to go up there and, because these people were harassing our party members, and he wanted to make peace. So
you were hosting the Lunar Eclipse Party at a campsite next door to where this altercation took place?
In the Hoosier National Forest public land. We were fine to be there. Yeah. Vox and Ian, they walk off down there. Myself, Steven, and Max were still at the camp. Max comes up to me just a minute or two later and says, "Man, I think we should just follow him, just to go check on him." I just got done swimming. I was almost naked. Got dressed. We walked over there, walked down towards that direction that Vox and Ian left towards the other camp. About halfway there, I hear something. My friends are behind me. I'm in front, and I motion them to be quiet because I thought I heard some yelling, and then a dog barks. One of the two behind me says, "Oh, that's just a dog." And we all agree. We take a couple more steps, and I hear yelling, distinct yelling. At that, I can't see anything. I just hear the yelling. At that point, I take off running towards the yelling. And a moment later, I come around a corner, and there's a large group of people down by the water. Some people scuttered off to the side, and immediately in front of me, four or five people huddled around a tree. I'm assessing the situation. I'm sensing danger. I know my friends are behind me somewhere, but I feel like I'm by myself kind of at this point. I then notice that these people huddled around the tree have Vox pinned down, wrestling with them. They were being very violent. I feel that they were very intoxicated. As soon as I saw that, I'm about 20 feet away, I said, "Let him go. Get their attention." Yell, they like, I don't think they really knew I was there yet. "Let him go." And they turn, a couple turn around, and they start harassing me and yelling at me. I step a little closer. "Let him go." They're saying, "You guys get out of here." And I'm saying, "I will, once you let him go." Then I hear, leave the boy here, or you get out of here, leave the boy with us, and a few other choice racial slurs. And at that point, I pull out my phone because I feel it's really dangerous, and I don't see any of my other friends. I see a bunch of people in front of me, and it's just me with Vox on the ground. I pull out my phone out of a sense of danger. I wasn't planning on going down there and recording ever. Like, I didn't have my phone out at first. A lot of stuff happened before I started recording. I got my phone out to protect myself, because I was, at this point, I was worried that something really bad might happen. Maybe worried for my life. I was certainly worried for Vox's life. So I get my phone out. I start recording. I continue advancing, yelling at them, getting their attention. I finally get about 5 feet away, as you can see in the video, and I'm pretty close. And I get accosted. Two men attack at me, swipe at me, push at me. A lady that's off camera grabs my arm. I'm not letting go of my phone, so I know I'm not letting go of my phone. I put it in my pocket as the lady is trying to grab it out of my hand, I believe. Two guys are pushing at me. I kind of sidestep them. They were kind of drunk, so it wasn't real hard. I sidestep them, and I reach up. I reach to the tree. I get closer, and I tap the man in the red shirt on his shoulder, and he turns and looks at me. right in my eye, and I say, let him go. And at that point, Vox stands up, and I ask him if he's okay. He's obviously shaking, and his hair's a mess, and scuffed up and dirty, and I kind of like make sure he gets in front of me. I turn around, trying to keep, intentionally keeping myself between their group and ours, and we walk up towards the hill, followed by their group yelling insults. It's all on video. A lot of that part is on video, and we get back to our camp.
Had you ever seen the people that were in this group that were attacking Vox before?
No. Like I say, on my way in the camp, I walked along the shore.
Right.
I didn't even really know they were there.
And so when you were in that moment and you saw them, you know, holding him down, you said, you know, you not only feared for your life, but also for Vox's. So you truly feel that they wanted you all to leave and for him to stay, and that they had intentions to kill him.
That's exactly what I feel. Intentions to harm him could have been to do serious harm. It could have been to kill him.
And, you know, in the video, you see a lot of the person who you see who is, you know, yelling and holding boxes, the man in the red shirt. Do you feel that there were other people that, just because of the view of where the video is taken from, are also, you know, accountable for what happened? Were there more people holding him down other than just that one man in the red shirt?
Yes. Before I started filming, their demeanor changed when they saw the cameras. And no one in their party was asking to let him go until we got there and pulled out their cameras. And then a few of their parties, thankfully, were trying to get them to release them too, but only after we arrived.
So then what were those people doing that were around them? Were they standing silently? Were they
No, they were scuffling with them. There was two or three men actively scuffling with him at the very least, and others very close by.
And then you see there's a group, I know there's a girl that was calling one of the men, you know, Dad, let him go. There were a couple other women there. What were those group of people doing? Were they also helping hold him down, or they just kind of weren't doing anything at the cameras?
They were just kind of huddled around. They weren't helping. I don't think, not everyone was helping him hold him down. It wasn't like everyone was there holding him down. There was three to four people holding him down at first. And then it goes from there. I don't really.
So in your opinion, if you all, you know, the other people that were there as well as yourself that had their phones out there with Vox, if you were not there, do you think the situation would have ended differently?
I think it would have ended very differently. I also think a few moments before this happened to Vox, we had a female from our party leave, and they were nice to her on the way out. I also feel if it was me, or any one of our other campers, that wouldn't have happened. That's just my personal feeling of the situation. I do think, because of the color of Vox's skin, that this happened to him.
Let me ask you, since this has gone viral, and it seems like a lot of people are questioning Vox's story, but not really questioning the other people in the video, their story. What's your thoughts, just as someone who was there, and the fact that a lot of people aren't questioning or trying to turn this around on Vox? What's your thoughts on that?
I understand, because the whole incident's not on camera, so it's taking our words for it. I understand that. I wasn't there when the first attack happened. I walked up on the scene basically as you see it in my footage. I know, from what I know of Vox, he's not a violent man. He's a soft-spoken man. I know he wasn't trying to cause any... he wasn't kind of trying to cause any problems along those lines, I don't believe. But I wasn't there. I kind of lost track of the question. So I'm sorry.
Can you just tell us your first, your last name, and then spell it out for us?
Brennan Golightly. Brennan Golightly. Golightly. Yeah.
Thank you, Brennan.
Is that it?
Thank you, folks.